For no holds were barred, with no moral guard set on devilry, where claims to a kingdom served only to bring them to blows, whereby pikemen and bowmen and sword-wielding showmen and cavalry were unheeding the clarion, left bleeding as carrion for crows. When a new son of York, refusing all talk of an amnesty, with Warwick his aid, then his kingmaker made her take flight. And when kingmaker spurned, and the she-wolf returned with their dynasty, slain were he and her prince in the fray, then her king in the night. Although Duke Richard's first son Edward had made ground campaigning westward and demolished Margaret's Welsh at Mortimer's Cross, Earl Warwick, recking north from London, spied royal troops in such abundance that St. Albans this time marked a Yorkist lost. But Margaret's vengeance worse than gruesome left the choice of execution of her prisoners to her seven-year-old son. And Edward, racing north to Taunton, put Lancastrians to rout, enabling Warwick to proclaim the crown was won. Margaret's fortunes further tumbled from the marches to Northumberland as Warwick seized her castles for his king. She hoped that French or Scots might check them, but both Heckleymore and Hexham were defeats from which but little hope could spring. Till Edward wed his widow Woodville, whose kin rose as Warwick stood still. His proposed liaison française to a port, and joined by Edward's brother Clarence, bound to lose his heir apparent. One at Edgecote then heard Edward had been caught. But Edward, freed for goodwill promised, thought it not the least dishonest when he drove them dubbed great rebels off to France, where Warwick knelt before Queen Margaret, Henry King once more their target with his Anne, her Edward marrying their advance. Yet when by Plymouth Warwick landed, raising high King Henry's standard, Edward fleeing to the Hague still planned to reign. Clarence rejoined him whence at Barnet Warwick died beyond the carnage. Then at Tewkesbury Edward, Margaret's prince, was slain. So take a moment further to imagine it, new wounds, their death throes still as echoes heard, two beds of roses freshly turned Plantagenet, neath which their flowering manhood was interred. Clarence, who'd loathed his brother trothed to Lancaster, condemned to die, his treason past control. Margaret condemned to live, for when York ransomed her, beside the 50,000 crowns her toll, she'd lost her son, her husband,